Okay, the Eloi Nishmat, help me.
Vega Bat Moshe Akoin.
Moshe Akoin. Shlomo asked me just if I would say a few words, and it happens to be that I brought this shiur with me because I thought I was going to give a shiur in Camp Hask, and I didn't, and it was about Sarah Imenu. So I thought that was perfect for the matriarch of a family to speak about Sarah Imenu. So I wanted to speak about Sarah as an innovator, and think a little bit about what her personality, how she began, and who she ended up to be. And I think there's a parallel, someone who starts something new. I think there's a parallel, there's an interesting story of a woman named, eventually her name became Chemdat Ben Yehuda. I'm sorry, I'm over there.
I'm okay.
Okay.
I hear you well.
Okay, Chemdat Ben Yehuda was a pioneer woman, but in a very interesting way. Her husband was the famous Eliezer Ben Yehuda, who decided in the 1800s, the late 1800s, to revive the Hebrew language as a spoken language, and started Hebrew. He moved from Europe, he came to Israel, and he started a Hebrew newspaper, and he revived the Hebrew language. But his family was a very interesting story. He married a wonderful woman who carried his dream. They moved to Israel from Europe and began to have the first Hebrew-speaking household. She died of tuberculosis when she was a young woman, leaving five young children. And her last wish, or his wish, was that he marry her sister. So this sister, who was eventually Chemdat, her name was Paula, or Paulina, she lived in Russia, and she was part of she was in University of Russia and part of the Russian culture, and she loved it there. And she left everything to go take care of her sister's children, moved to the old city of Yerushalayim, and joined her brother-in-law. And it wasn't at all her dream. She was living her life in Russia very happily, very involved in Russian culture, and she came, he changed her name to a Hebrew name, to Chemdat, and they began, and she raised these children, and then had more children with him, and they became the first Hebrew-speaking household in Eretz Yisrael at the time. Now, what was interesting about this woman, Chemdat, is that she eventually not only joined his dream and his mission of becoming Hebrew-speaking, but after he died, she finished his dictionary, and she was known as his partner in all ways in this mission. But she never had this mission, never thought she would be this mission. Only because of life circumstances did she end up moving and changing her entire life course. And it said, the stories about her, that within 6 months she was fluent in Hebrew, raising the children and helping him in his newspaper and in his Hebrew. So I think this story is a sort of more modern day story of Sarah Imenu. Sarah Imenu was just a regular person who married a guy named Avram, not knowing anything. And then Hashem appears to Avram and says, Lech lecha me'artzecha me'moladetecha, go on this great mission. And he had this great ideal that what he wanted to do, but she wasn't at all part of it. She had to, in the ancient world, people didn't move across the world. She packed her bags, went with her husband. It wasn't her vision, it wasn't her course of life, she just started as a regular person. And then she went with him to Eretz Yisrael, and as the Chachamim tell us, it says that they gathered v'hanefesh asher asu b'Haran, all of the souls that came from Haran. She converted the women, he converted the men, and so what was her husband's sort of vision became her own vision. And she spent many, many years of her life as the building up the Jewish faith, or the monotheistic faith. And I just wanted to read one thing here that Adin Steinzelt speaks about. He says, he talks about her. Once again, we find the image of Avraham and Sarah as partners, working together along the same path, united in thought, word, and deed. This is an example of a man and wife bound together not by family affairs. For most of their life, they were childless, but by working together with an uncommon intimacy for a shared ideal. This kind of relationship can be encountered in modern times, but certainly extremely rare in ancient times. This is how Avram and Sarah saw themselves, not as a couple raising a family, but as a people, building a society, realizing an ideal, parents of a nation. And so they built up this nation together, working together for this ideal that originally was Avraham, but she joined him and sort of got on board. And then what happens to Sarah is that something changes, that finally at a certain point she says, I don't want to only build a nation, I want to build a family. And after 10 years of being in Eretz Yisrael, she says, fine, Avraham, take Hagar. And Avraham took Hagar, and an interesting thing, unlike Rachel, who brings in Bilhah, when she took Hagar, she says, Ulai ibaneh mimena, maybe I will be built up from her. But then she gets upset when Hagar gets pregnant, starts to show her, like, weight around. And so she starts to be very mean to Hagar. Hagar runs away, and Sarah couldn't care less. So if she wanted this child, why would she be mean? If it was a surrogate, like we would say, that she was harboring her child, like Rachel was with Bilhah, she should treat her well, she should pay her doctor bills, she should take care of her. But instead, Hagar runs away. So perhaps what Sarah was thinking was that if I give Abraham Hagar, then maybe I myself will merit a child. She wasn't hoping to be a surrogate to Hagar's, having a surrogate child, but rather what she really wanted more than anything was to have her own child. And very right afterwards, she is blessed indeed with her own child. And then Sarah's life changes completely. From this pioneer woman coming and sort of reaching out, she focuses inward, and she's so focused on the raising of Yitzchak and the raising of her family. And it's a second stage in Sarah's life where it completely changes from an outward to an inward, from building a nation to building a family. And then she dies at the age of 127. And the pasuk says, "Vayhi chayei Sarah mea shana ve'esrim shana ve'sheva shanim shnei chayei Sarah." So it's very repetitive, as we know. So Chachamim says, say when she was 20, it was like she was 7. In that she was, I'll just read it. Bat mea kibat esrim lachay. When she was 100, it was like she was 20 with sin. Mi bat esrim lachay tare. Bat inana bat ernshi. You don't deserve punishment. When she was 20, she was like 7 with beauty. So she was all of these ages merged into one. Rav Soloveitchik says that most people, we look at people in their bodies, and you're either young, middle-aged, or old. But he says in your spirit, you could be all of them at the same time. An old person could have the joy of youth, the idealism of youth. A young person could have the wisdom of old age. And he says that's what Sarah was. When Chachamim say when she was 20, she was like 7, and when she was 7, she was like 100, she was 20. He says, I'll just read the Rav Soloveitchik's words. He says, Sarah at 20 was mature and fully developed both intellectually and emotionally. She was energetic, old, and daring. Yet the adult in Sarah did not destroy the child. She acted like a mature, wise, experienced, rich old woman. But in times of need and crisis, the young, bold, courageous girl came to the fore and took over. And so she was 127 in her spirit all at the exact same time. So I was thinking about Sarah, and I was thinking about Elter Rebbe, and I really don't have really the authority to speak about her, but with your permission, I just jotted down something that I was thinking a lot about Sarah, and sort of about this woman, Chemdat ben Yehuda, or that type of person, who starts off their life as a regular person, not expecting anything great or grand, and not necessarily even ideals. I'm just thinking, I'm just going to live a simple, simple life. And life circumstances changes them into someone who really is changes history. So just like Sarah, I thought maybe Bubby had three stages of her life. So in the first stage of her life, Sarah was creating a people, or the 7-year-old Sarah, sorry. We have the 7, the 20, and the 100. So for Bubby, I thought maybe this reflects the three stages of her life as well. Not that I knew her then, but I ran it by Shlomo. He said it was okay. In the early stages of her life, she was a young girl in Poland. That represents like the 7, a simple living her life, not expecting to have too many challenges, just like a young girl, a Vaisyakov student. And then the middle of her life, that was like Sarah in Haran, just living her life. Unbeknownst to her, she marries this guy, Avram, and her life changes. And that's the middle stage of her life, where Sarah was the builder of a nation, and perhaps this was the time when Bubby was during the war trying to survive without a family, and not only to survive for the sake of her family, but for the sake of the Jewish people. And it was because of the tenacity and the strength of survivors that we have a people. So in some sense, it was that idea of building a nation, doing something altruistic for others and for future generations. And then just as Sarah afterwards had a third stage of her life, where she focused not outward, not on the Jewish people, but rather inward, the focus on building and raising her family and grandchildren. And it was only at this stage of her life, during the third stage of her life, that I had this chud of meeting her. But what I always thought in Bubby is that, kind of like Sarah Imena, maybe she had all three stages mixed in one. There was a certain innocence that emunah pshutah, almost like a 7-year-old, always believed, always had faith. always innocent, never too complicated, and yet the strength of the idealistic 20-year-old who believes in something greater, the strength of survival, that even in her old body, she had that strength, and ultimately the wisdom of the 100-year-old Sarah, the wisdom of someone who has seen a lot and understands the world. So it should be an aliyat neshama that we should learn from her in all three stages of her life, the innocence, the purity of a 7-year-old, the strength and struggle to survive of the middle age, and the third is the wisdom of old age, as Sarah had and as our role model should have.
I just think that probably had the opposite stages out of order, that you know when the age of 100 went to wisdom, she really had it when she was 7 and surviving the war. And her love for life, even when she was 100 or close to 100, that 7-year-old feeling of living a young life. And it was all, you know, the mile is that you don't live like a 7-year-old with a 7-year-old. She lived like a 100-year-old when she was a 7-year-old. And a 70-year-old when she was a 100-year-old.
Oh. And she can live vicariously through her grandchildren and great-grandchildren.
Right.
And to have that joy of young children around, only at an older age.
The din did not bother her. She never complained about the noise.
One thing I was going Friday afternoon to up the stairs over here to Bobby's to get the chutney.
Oh.
Bobby would always come and prepare the cranberry. And I knew it.
So good.
There's not
cranberry sauce.
That also.
All that
but, you know,
he's thinking about just, chutney right now.
Those door, you know, the door was never locked, or when it was locked, it would come in. He knocked on the door. So as we were going in, Bobby would come with her brown or beige pants and the little white sweater, and they come to the door one minute, you know, with her eyes always open like that, and she'd come, go over there, I have everything ready for you, and she'd take out from the refrigerator the cranberry sauce, and then she would take out the pie and put the tinfoil on it and make sure it was always perfect. So, oh, it came out a little bit, the blueberry, well, not perfect.
Who cares?
I said, Bobby, it doesn't matter.
That's
she always wanted perfection, but she did with such love and giving it to us. And I remember when I went, I knew that how many more years we were going to have doing this. So I kept it in my memory to remember afterwards. So that is my memory.
It's a nice memory.
Rahula said she remembers that Bubby was sweet and always gave them nice treats.
Oh. The cookies with the one
chocolates.
Chocolate chip.
No.
Two.
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 That was really generous.
It was a generous day.
That was a good thing to call goodies cookie or a good serve.
I always was amazed by the pages, those sticking ones with chocolate in every.
Yeah, she liked them because
she didn't
want to overdo
like
it.
All
right.
Chocolate. Mm.
She wouldn't let us have indulge, so she didn't, she didn't let anyone indulge.
So are you listening? I'll support you.
No.
Shlomi, why don't you say something?
Yeah, come on.
You have nice memories.
I have nice memories.
Ilana?
Lisi? The oldest granddaughter.
I always felt lucky I got to live with both.
The first granddaughter. Oh.
I was always the fortunate one that got to live with her and really see all her goodness and see, like, she always did everything, like, you know, it's a new, like, in a quiet,
right, gentle
way that no one, not no big fanfare, no one had to know about it. She just always did her thing, and everybody, I was very privileged to live and learn from her. I was always.
We got to live in our house for 3 months.
When we first got married, we lived there. Yeah. And Bobby was, I lived there in high school, and I never had like that feeling of someone's watching you and you shouldn't, you should. There was never like any judgment. I always say, Bobby taught me to make my bed, because she didn't say, make your bed, it doesn't look nice. She just went in my room every day and made my bed. So I quickly made my own bed so she wouldn't have to do it for me. And she knew everything that, anything that she knew from the Haim, she brought from Poland. she told me, you know, you're supposed to cover your nagelwasser by your bed. And I said, nah, no one does that. And then that's exactly what you're supposed to do, is cover it so there's no, the water's not open.
That's nagelwasser.
So.
You don't want the, you don't want the, you don't want the, you don't want the snake to go.
Right. No, but she brought everything and she always referenced, like, that's how they did it in the Haim. You know, she had
even bench left on the table.
Right.
That's where you're supposed to bench.
Except if you have seven children.
Lisa,
no, but
I like to say, one thing my Bubba used to tell me, that in Poland when she was a little girl, her mother would make food for Shabbos for people who needed food. And her mother would never tell her the name of the people. You want to embarrass them. She just gave the address or wherever they live, and she delivered it.
Right.
She knew where the, you know, she, the address, she knew, but she, the names, she would never talk about names. And then I know in Rockford, also on Friday, she would make food and deliver for people who needed it. She never talked about it. No one knew. Or visit people who weren't well, but, you know, things like that. She was a very good soul. Get to the Shabbat.
And she had a vested interest in everybody she talked with. You know, she had conversations with everyone when we went to Rockford for Bonnie's funeral or whatever I think it was. And afterwards, and they had the, you know, everyone was there.
In the
shul? Yeah, social. Yeah, and she was genuinely interested in everybody, you know, listening to what they had. You know, she just broke, brushed somebody off to, you know, listen.